We have a lot to do today, and we are going to finish up chapter 11 talking about this other way to do regression estimates and to do significance tests using analysis of variance, basically breaking down the variability of the y's, the total variability of them, into the part that's due to the model and the part that's left in the errors. So we talked about that before, and we just have one more example left to do. Maybe we should look at the summary so we remember what the idea was here. Okay, so let's just turn to page 53 and remember what we're doing, and then we can do one more example. And then you're going to have homework that's due Monday that's going to be three problems, I think two or three problems. Half the homework is on this chapter, and half is on chapter 12. So we're going to cover both today. All right, so this basic idea of hypothesis tests or significance tests, they're just the statistical check to see whether some effect you observe, some difference you see between what you observe and what you'd expect under the null is due to a particular cause or just due to chance variation, just due to the luck of the draw. And the numerator of the test statistic is always a measure of how large the effect is, and the denominator is a measure of how large the error is, the chance error is. And so we've looked at two basic situations. We looked at these Z and T tests, where you have a single signed number in the numerator, and you use that when you have a single difference, like a difference between two averages. Then we could use a Z or a T test. A difference between 2%, we would use a Z test. A difference between the observed slope minus the expected slope, or the observed correlation coefficient minus the expected correlation coefficient. This is what we've been focusing on here, and that's where we can do either a Z test if we have large N or a T test. We also remember back in stat 100 where we looked at the difference between two group averages or the difference between two group percents. Those all boiled down to a single signed number. All right? But now, what's these chi-squared and F-tests? That's when you can't express the size of the effect. It can't be boiled down to a single difference with a sign. You have to look at the whole pattern of differences. Now, this is where we're heading towards. We're heading towards multiple regression, just right after we do this, and there's going to be more than one slope. And we want to assess the effect of both slopes at once. And we can't, there's no way to just boil, some of the slopes might be positive, some might be negative. We can't simply subtract. We want to look at, or let's say we have multiple categories. Let's say we want to compare three means, not just the difference of two means. Well, then we want to look at the whole pattern and see if that differs from what we'd expect under the null. And in these cases, we have to square a set of differences and combine them. Basically take the sum of the squares, which is a variance, right? And then, or type of variability, and combine them so that the positive and negatives don't cancel each other out. For example, remember back in Stat 100, we did the chi-square goodness of fit test when we wanted to see whether we had some model that had more than two categories? For example, if we wanted to see whether there was an even distribution, or if we had some idea that maybe if you selected a jury, it should be representative of the population. So one example we did was, well, is the jury panel representative of, if it was selected by a random draw from a population that has some mixture of, let's say, Asians, blacks, and whites, we wanted to see if it reflected that difference that would occur. You're not going to have exactly what the percentages in the chance that exist in the population, but you want to know if it's within chance error. And so we had three categories, and you have to look at the differences. You know, we have, of all three of them, to see if the model fits. It's that we're doing the same type of thing here. We're using a chi-square or an F-test. So we're going to get the ratio, with an F-test, we'll get the ratio of two variances. All right. And now for simple regression, we can always, we can use the Z and the T test. You just have one slope, so it does boil down to a single sign difference. But I just wanted to show you how if you square the Z, you will get the you will get a chi-squared distribution. And if you square the T, you will get the F distribution with one degree of freedom for its numerator. All right. And but in our next section on multiple regression, we won't be able to use the Z's and the T's. So just we won't be able to use those because we're going to be assessing all the slopes, multiple slopes that could be positive or negative. So we're going to have to move over and use the chi-squared and F-tests. All right. And then for all these significance tests, the bigger the test statistic, the smaller the p-value, the further away it is from the null, and the less likely it would be due to chance. The difference, the effect you see would be due to chance under the null. So, and there's two factors for all these that influence the size of the test statistics. One is the size of the effect, of the observed effect. If it, you know, you got a big effect, the bigger the effect, the more likely you'll get a significant effect. And then the sample size. The bigger the sample size, the more likely you'll get a significant result. Think about it. If you sampled the entire population, you are going to, no matter what difference, even if it's a tiny little difference, it will be statistically significant, right? Wouldn't it? I mean, statistically significant just means that if you say, that's the definition. So if you had data on the entire population and you see a difference, no matter how tiny it is, it's statistically significant. That doesn't mean it's significant in the usual sense, everyday language that we use, that we care about it. It might be completely trivial and unimportant. So statistical significance is very different than practical significance, and that's what you have to decide. You're not going to get a statistical a significance test that's going to tell you whether it's really significant in the way that we use that in ordinary language. Okay. Now, let's just do this last. Oh, and here, just working backwards here, this is what you did for homework so far. You've got these four in the simple regression. We're still at just simple linear regression. We've got these four test statistics that tell us basically the same thing. So which one do you use when and how do you use them? So basically, for small n, the T and the F give somewhat more accurate p-values than they do for Z and chi-square. Basically, what you're doing is that the T and the F are assuming that you don't know the standard deviation of the whole population, of the errors in the whole population, which you usually don't. If you don't, and that you're estimating it from a small sample. And those estimates get progressively better as n gets bigger. And so once n is big enough, that doesn't matter so much. All right. And which ones should we use, Z and T, or squaring them, the chi-square and the F? Well, we have to remember that the chi-square and the F, they're squared. They're squared, so they're always positive, right? They're always positive because they are squared. So that means that you can't distinguish between a negative or a positive Z or T, right? And so they always yield p-values that are like a two-sided alternative. Maybe I should show you this. The p-value for the chi-square is always equal to the area of both tails on the normal curve, and the p-value for the F is always equal to the area of both tails on the t-curve. Okay, so let's illustrate this just with a. So here, we'll draw the chi-squared, and we'll draw a z. Okay, so you know what the z looks like, the normal curve, like that, right? And it's centered at 0. So you have negative z-scores and you have positive z-scores. Now, and so you can say, okay, You look at how your z statistic and you see how far out it is away from what you'd expect, which is zero. And then your p-value, if it was an alternative was that you think it's going to be lower, that the alternative is that your statistic is going to be less than zero, like your slope or whatever it is, or here it would be higher than zero, and your p-value is either the area of one of these tails or both. Okay, so now this chi-squared is with 1 degree of freedom. I'll put a little one down there. With 1 degree of freedom means you just have one slope in your model, so it's equivalent to this is equal to the z squared. So let's think about what it would look like. So if it's, for example, what do I mean by that? I said, okay, if you have one, you're going to get one here. Z, if you have a z statistic equal to one, well, then one squared is one. How about if z was equal to a half? Here, let me draw. What am I doing here? Let's just say this was 1, this is 2, this is 3, negative 1, negative 2, negative 3. Okay, so let's say it's a half right there. 10? All right, you square a half and you get a quarter. So let's make a curve here, and you can see it has to start at 0 because anything, you're never going to get a negative. Anything squared is going to be positive. So a half would translate into a quarter. Well, what about a negative a half? That would be negative a quarter. Not negative a quarter. Negative a half times negative a half is positive a quarter, right? So anything between negative 1 and 1 is going to, when you square it, when you square a fraction, a number less than 1, or then it's going to get smaller, right? It's going to get smaller. Half times half is a quarter. Negative half times negative half is a quarter. So you're going to get this huge pile up here, like that. Going to look like that. It's not going to look like half of that or even like double half of that. It's going to look like this. And now, think about it. If you get a z, whatever you get z here, let's say it's 2, and here's negative 2, this would be negative z, are you going to be able to distinguish those? No, you're only going to get positive numbers. So 2 squared would be 4, and negative 2 squared would be 4. So basically, this area here would be the same as, both of those would be the same as getting a chi-square statistic, chi-squared here, equal to z squared or equal to 4. It's going to be both these tails together because it's going to lump this part and this part. So it's like a two-sided alternative. Is that clear to everybody? Does that make sense? Got a nod so I can see. Hey guys, come on. Look, so people can, are you nodding? Let's see nods. Oh, it's, you're so blurry. All right. Okay, now, similarly, we're gonna have the same thing with the t. It's gonna look very similar. So here we have the f with 1 degree of freedom, and that's going to be like what? With 1 degree of freedom is going to be like the t. T always, you can't have a t, you can't do a t if you have more than one slope. So it's going, but t does have its degrees of freedom, and it's always n minus 2. So the n minus 2 matches up here, and the 1 matches up here because it means 1x. So the f distribution, the numerator, degrees of freedom is the same as the chi-square, and the denominator is the same as the t here. All right, so let's draw it, and of course it looks very much like the t as well. It's just fatter in the tails for the same effect. And so now we're going to have the same type of distribution. Again, you're going to get an f that's a little bit smaller than the equivalent chi squared and a p that's a little bit bigger. And your t is going to be a tiny bit, this will be negative t for the equivalent data, it would be a little bit smaller than z. And smaller by a factor of the square root of n over square root of n minus 2 over n. And of course, as n gets big, that approaches 1. And the curves approach the normal curve. So that's the idea. So now here are our statistics in a nutshell. And we derived these before. This was basically the slope over the standard error for the slope. And the SDY over SDX canceled out. And we got this, which simplified to this. You square it, and you get chi squared. Similarly here. So if you just look at this, this makes a lot of sense in terms of what we just said before. This is, remember we said that basically the numerator is the strength of the model, and the denominator is the strength of the error. And the bigger your sample size, the more extreme, bigger your test statistics will be, which means the less, the more significant your results will be. So that's the idea. It's not working because I didn't have it turned on. Okay, so we're back on. This is for all the folks, the students who didn't come to class today. They can hear this. So what I said was, okay, so now we're going to, our homework is going to focus on a problem like this and a problem, I guess you're going to get one like you had for tonight's homework. But this one, you have to fill out this chart. So let's look at it. And here's this regression. What are we doing? We're predicting finals from homework scores on a group of 107 students. And we're saying they're a random sample from a larger population. And we got this correlation of 0.4, a positive correlation, which makes sense. You'd think that people who do better on the homework, above average on the homework, are going to do above average on the final as well, and vice versa. But we're wondering, yeah, we got in our sample, but would it hold up if we polled everyone, all 2,000 students? So the null hypothesis is the slope of the regression equation for the whole population is really zero. Knowing somebody's homework tells you nothing about their final exam scores. And this observed difference that we get, we didn't actually calculate the slope, but we can see that we certainly could, 0.4 times 10.3 divided by 11.7. That difference is only due to chance variation. And the alternative is, I think the slope, you would probably, common sense would tell you to do a directional one, because you, most people would think, what, homework is what, positively or negatively correlated with? Wouldn't you think positive? Yeah. But this is saying these F tests are non-directional. So all you're saying is you don't know. It's either positive or negative. Maybe it's a situation where, who knows, maybe some classes the homework hurts you. It has nothing to do with what's on the exam and actually confuses you. I can imagine a situation where maybe you're thinking, okay, we know that the homework has some effect, but we're not sure whether it's positive or negative. That's what this is saying. Kind of weird, but. Okay, of course, whatever we get, whatever p-value we get, we don't have to worry about it, because if we want to change it to a directional and make it more sensible, if we do it ahead of time, if we say we really want greater than zero here, but we're looking at this data here, so you can then divide it by two. All right, so let's see what we need to do here. To fill out, okay, so now fill in the table using the stats. Now we don't have to calculate, as we just saw, All we need is this. We don't need to calculate the slope. So we're just, this is 0.4. This is y here, because we're predicting that 10.3. And n is 107, our sample size. So that's what we've got here. All right, now we're gonna want to get r squared and 1 minus r squared, so we might as well do that now. So r squared, this is 0.4, so r squared is what? It's 0.16. And then 1 minus r squared is what? 1 minus that, so it's 0.84. Okay. And Any questions? All right. So now what should we do here? How about these degrees of freedom? We talked about them last time. They're kind of hanging people up. So this, remember we said that the total degrees of freedom are the same as if you're just estimating a mean, this is just the variation of the y's, n minus 1. So in this case, it's what? 107 minus 1. So that's 106. And then we said that these two are going to sum to that. All right? And we said that the degrees of freedom for the model is, well, how many parameters? It says it has two parameters. Why? Because there's two betas here. The intercept, we're estimating an intercept, and a slope. So the number of parameters is equal to 2. Let's write that down. But the model degrees of freedom just refer to the number of x's, the number of predictor variables. So it's, in general, it's what? P, we're going to add multiple slopes later. So it's the number of all the betas, but minus the intercept. So just the x's. So in this case, it's 2 minus 1, which is equal to 1. Okay, so 1 plus, well, we know this has to be 105. They have to add up. But the way you should think about it is what? This is the entire sample size, n, minus the parameters, the number of parameters. And, of course, they sum. So in this case, it's 107 minus 2. So you have 1 plus 105 equals 106. All right, now, similarly, these sums of squares add. So the sum of squares total, well, luckily we have the standard deviation here, so we don't have to calculate it from scratch. This is like the first step in calculating is the standard deviation. It's the deviation of the y values from their mean squared and summed. So you square each of those differences from the mean, and then you sum them. If you take the average, the mean of them, and then take the square root, you have the standard deviation. So this SST is going to be equal to n times the standard deviation of the y value squared. So in this case, it's 107 times 10.3 squared. So what do we get when we do that? 107 times 10.3 squared, and we get that. All right, should we put all the decimals in and everything? We could. All right, so we'll just do this. So that is 11351.63. And just to tell you what I did there, well, you have it right here. Okay. Now, how are we going to get which one? Now, if we want to get this one, we're just going to multiply that by what? This is r squared, so r squared is 0.16. So we just want 0.16 times that. So we'll multiply that by 0.16. And there we've got, can you read that? I'm just, okay, question. See, maybe I'll put it right there. That's easy. Okay, so now we have 16.26. And now, if you wanted to, you could just subtract that from the sum of squares total. They have to add up. Or you could just say 0.84, 1 minus, this is 0.16. This is, see, they're just dividing in this 16% and 84%. So that's 0.84 times the same thing, 11351. 6, 3, and what do we get? So that gives us this here is 9, 5, 3, 5.37. So we have this plus that equals that. All right. So now what do we do? Now, to get the mean squares over here, remember this F ratio is the ratio of these mean squares. You have to take an average, right? This is, so we have to take the average, basically a mean. This is the mean square for the model, mean square for the model, and this is going to be the mean square for our error. And so how do we do that? We just are going to take, for this one, what are we going to divide by? We'll take this 9, 5, and we're going to divide it by what? By the degrees of freedom, which is 105. And that's what we put in here. So this is equal to 90.81. All right, so just in case you're looking at this later, this is what? 9535.37 divided by 105, and we got 90.81. And that's going to be our denominator here, 90.81. And our numerator is just going to be 1816.26 divided by its degrees of freedom. So we have 1816.26. All right. And we'll see what that is. So we're going to take 9535, right, 0.3692. And we're going to divide it by what we got there. That's wrong. What did I do wrong? Okay, so we did 9. Let's do it again. 9535.3692, and we're going to divide it. Oh, I see what I did wrong. Look what I'm doing. I have to take 1816. Sorry. Sorry. Why didn't you all say, Ellen, stop? I'm not doing that. Look, it's written, this is what I'm trying to do. Okay, clear. Okay, we're starting over. So we want 18. 16. I wanted to leave all the decimal places in because it's going to come out to a nice round number, but I screwed up. So I'm just going to do the 90.81, and what do we get? I wanted you get exactly 20, but that's the rounding error there. Ta-da! All right. Now you probably can see that really why it's really exactly the same thing as doing what? Is how we're going to check it if r squared is provided. So if r squared is provided, it's just r squared over 1 minus r squared times what? 105 divided by 1. And you can see that because this is r, look, the SSTs, we have this one divided by that one. Right? And the SSTs, this is this one. You have this over that, and the SSTs cross out. So you have r squared over 1 minus r squared, 0.16 over 0.84. And then this is in the, you know, then this is in the denominator here, this is in the denominator here. So it simplifies to 105 divided by 1. And that should be, we don't have to do any rounding, that's much easier, so we get 0.16 divided by 0.84 times 105. And there's your 20. Okay. So, I don't know. If you're given the r squared, then you just obviously can do that. But it's nice to know this, how this breaks down, and especially because, look at this. This mean square error here, this right here, this mean square error, if you take the square root of it, it's the root mean square error. The root mean square error. So if you take the square root of that, you're going to get your root mean square error, which is the square root of 1 minus r squared times the standard deviation of the y, except it's actually, because we're here, we're adjusting it for the f-test, it's actually sdy plus, where sdy plus is just equal to what? The square root of, instead of dividing by 107, we're going to divide by 105, so it's a little bit bigger, so it's 107 over 105 times the sdy here. So that's that right here. When you take the square root of that, that's known as your this right here. The square root of 90.81 would be called your standard deviation plus of your errors. So it's a tiny bit. That's an estimate. All right. So now find P. Well, F is 20. So our actual F that we got, our F statistic equals 20. That's huge. When the null is true, you'd expect an F of about 1. This is huge. Now, how can we look that up? Well, we could compare it to the critical value of F with 1 degree of freedom in the numerator and 105 in the denominator at alpha equals what? What do you want to say? 5%? We could do it also at 1%, and we can compare it to 20. Is that bigger than, let's look, so we have this, so the idea is this, that these are the critical values for 5%. So, for example, with 1 degree of freedom, we know the curve, the F curve kind of looks like that. And these tell you where the cutoff is for 5%. So that's your F star for all, you know, for example, we're here at 1 and 105. So to be conservative, we could choose, certainly if it's bigger than 4, it's going to be bigger than anything with more n. So we could say it's 60, or we could choose estimate. It's about, look, 4 and 3.9. We don't really have to quibble because we have 20. So it's way out here. That's our F stat. So the p-value is tiny. Do you understand? Even we can look here at 1%, and of course we're going to get a bigger, you know, this is 5%. 1% is going to be bigger than 4. It's going to be further along. So what do we have here? See, it's somewhere between what? About 6.9. But we're way bigger than that. Does that make sense, everybody? Yeah. On this chart, we are looking at the critical values. Each one of these little squares, there's a lot of F curves, and each one is a different curve. And so we're picking out the curve between, look, we're just estimating. They can't even list. We want 1 and 105. Well, do you know how many pages it would be if they gave tables for each curve? So they're giving the critical value, not the actual p-value. They're just giving the cutoff point. So if we get an F greater than about 3 point, somewhere in between there, we can reject the null at the 5% level. Here, we could reject the null at the, if we get one greater than between 7 and, what is this, 6.85, ours is much, much bigger. Where if the null was true, we would expect to get an F value about 1. We're so far from that. Why don't we look at our actual tables, and I can show you what F curves look like, and maybe that would make more sense. So let's just go to here for a moment. You have this handy p-value calculator. And so we can look at an F distribution, and we can look exactly what R with 1 degree of freedom here, and 105 in the denominator, and we got a statistic of 20, we can see what our actual p-value is. And it's tiny. And there is where it is, that tiny little area. And if the null was true, we'd expect it about 1. And if you start getting more degrees of freedom, let's say we have 20 degrees of freedom, it's going to start looking like the normal curve. Watch. Now we're going to compute. You see, but it's centered at 1. With 100, we could just do more here. We could even do more here. Bigger N. Now watch, it's still going to be centered at 1. All right. So if you get, when the null is true, you'd expect, and this makes sense because think about what the F-stat is. Let's go back to the document camera. The F-stat is measuring these two, look at this. Where are we? Let's go. This is all new to everybody, so don't worry if you don't get it right away, but let's look at the structure of this. What are we doing here? We're basically looking at the ratio between these two variances, sum of squares for the model and sum of squares for the error. So let's go back to our just intuitive picture. And what we're saying is the sum of squares for the model is like taking all the distances. How much does our model, which is this regression line, help predict our values of y compared to just using the average of y? So, for example, we looked at this one person here who the average would have predicted this person. The average would be, no matter what they get, you know, I don't care what you get on your exams, I'm just going to predict the average for all of you, 74. So our regression line for this particular person who got this guy right here, point D. So this person got a 92, and if we were just using the average, we would have predicted, 74. But our regression line yielded 79. So we improved by 5 there. But our error, he actually did him really well. And our error, he got all the way up to 95. So we were off, even our prediction left 16 left to be explained. So that's the distance, that's the improvement due to the model, and that's our error. If all of ours, if it wasn't much better, you know, okay, so then let's look at another one. Here we did much better. This we did quite, you know, there's our prediction. We did pretty good, and our error was here. This person we did phenomenal on. Perfect prediction there. All right. This person, it would have been better to use the average. The actual was there. That's closer. We predicted. Our prediction was worse. Okay, so we take into account all of them, and we're comparing that. The bigger that is, the bigger those distances are, you know, the better our predictions are. So that's our numerator, the model's predictions. It's a measure of how good our model is, how much it differs from just the plain old average, the null. And then we're saying in the denominator, though, we have to say, well, we're comparing it to the errors. And if they're about the same, if they're about 1, well, that would mean that the pretty much like when the null is true, it's saying our model's no better than random chance. It's not a, you know, it's no better than our errors. Do you see what I mean? So when the null is true, your F ratio is going to be about 1. Does that make sense? Do you get it? Not if you get it. I mean, if the bigger that numerator is, the bigger the better our model is. You see, we're taking the average mean square. We're looking at the ratio of the mean square model, the average over the average. And when that's 1, when it's about when the null is true, when there's no, you know, just when the null is true, it means there's no relationship. The average is just as good as anything else, any other prediction. I mean, we're always going to get, we fit this regression line to this sample. So we're always going to do a little bit better. The question is, would it hold up, or is that just is that little bit of correlation just due to the luck of the draw? You got it? We're not going to fit something worse than this. All right. Now, I think that's enough, and I think you'll get a lot better feel for it when you do your homework. Let's move on to our next, our very next section, which is a lot more fun, I think, because we're actually going to dive right in, and we're going to look at the data. So, any questions so far? Any questions at all? Yes. For the Wednesday homework? Oh, you mean, oh, you skipped ahead and looked at the homework for after. Okay, there's three parameters. Yes, because we're going to move into multiple regression. That's our next section. There's two slopes. Today? Oh, the homework that was due yesterday, last night. There was, you have a question on that? You want me to pull it up, or?
I just wanted to, like, ask, like, what is the parameter? Because I think
what is a parameter? The parameters are these, the betas that we're trying to estimate. So we would have the number of parameters for the ones that we looked at were only two. Because we only had simple regression, and we had an intercept and a slope. Does that make sense? Yeah. And then the degrees of freedom for our model is just the number of slopes, which is one. All right. Any other questions? Yes. Will you have which formula are you asking about? On page what? On page 54, we're going to have these formulas. Oh, I think not. I think that it's much. Okay, so this is something people ask me all the time. Why can't they get formula sheets? Because the kind of studying and the thinking that goes into remembering those formulas is, how do you remember those effectively? You have to build, you have to understand the structure of them. You sort of really have to understand the pattern. And once you do that, you'll understand the formulas much better. People tell me this all the time. They say, how am I going to know these formulas? And then I say, well, look, for example, here's some formulas here. I say, look, the basic part of it is the r squared over the 1 minus r squared, right? Here. Now, and that's true here, too. It's just the square root. Chi squared, it's a square of the z. All right, now you look at these n's. And wouldn't you remember, you might get confused. Should this, you know, because this is the degrees of freedom in the denominator, so why is it appearing in the numerator here? Well, you know, an easy way to remember this is the bigger your test statistic, the further out on the tail you are, right? The bigger, like for a z score, the bigger your test, the bigger your test statistic. So your bigger your sample size. Let's look at this. So your bigger your, this is multiplying by your sample size. So you're going to go further and further out with a bigger sample size. For a given R, the more the bigger your sample size, you're going to get a bigger statistic out here, which means stronger beyond a reasonable doubt. You know, null, dull, innocence, we keep going further and further out, and our doubt becomes tinier and tinier that this was just due to chance. There's something real going on here. We're going to convict, or we're going to say, there's a real particular cause for it. This isn't just an innocent person happened to be picked up just by the, you know, random chance. This is, there's a real effect going on. And that's true with all of them, so you see how you make sense of it. That's going to increase the size of your, do you see what I'm saying? So you think of things like that and you learn, it's just, I want you to develop an intuition, to actually use this in your, just the idea of these significance tests, to know them cold, to know what p-values are. And you're never going to do that unless you spend some time thinking about what it all means. It's really useful. So you don't, and then you won't get so confused when you see, you know, these big, long formula sheets. I like to sort of unify things somewhat. Does that make sense? You're going to like, I mean, people do much better, much better. Otherwise, you bring it, you have this long set of formulas and with so many, it's like a instruction manual. It's not as much fun. There's not as much thinking goes on. Everyone tells me at first they're really scared, and I haven't had one, very rarely does somebody say, well, I wish we had, you know, you provided us with formula sheets or, you know, what is it, cheat sheets. It also means that I have to ask questions that are, it's hard, you know, I have to think about the type of questions I ask and ask questions that are, that hit more at the ideas and not just some tiny little twist on some form. You know what I mean? I have to be careful with the questions I ask. It makes me write a better exam and it makes you better test takers. I mean, better students. I mean, if it gets out of hand, I'll give you some formulas. I don't want you to just, you know, for sometimes if the formulas get really, there will be, but I'll always tell you ahead of time what formulas will be on there. Any other questions? All right. So moving along. Oh, boy. Okay. So you're going to like this section more. I'm going to like it more. Because we're going to dive in. We're going to dive in and look at some data. So let's look at this. What are we talking? What are we looking at here? This should look familiar to you because we are going to look at our data where we looked at shoe size. The bigger your foot, the fewer number of shoes you have. And this, we look back, we looked at this back on, this is the same graph we looked at on page 23. Let's look back for just to make sure that's the page number. If we go back to page 23, we were talking about causation and confounders here. And yep, here it is. And we saw this pretty strong negative correlation. And we think, what's going on here? Do you remember? Do you remember this? And we said, does big feet cause less people to have less shoes because it's hard to find shoes when you got big feet? Or could it be some kind of effect of gender being a confounder, that the males both have big feet and they buy less shoes? So we said, if we split our data stratified and just looked at with males, just among the males, we split the data into males and females, and if we just looked at among the males, then there might be no effect. And same with the females. That whether once you, you know, among just males, whether you when you have a big foot, it doesn't cause you to buy less shoes, and same with females, is what we said was going to happen. So that's stratification. And just because the effect of small feet was confounded with the effect of being female, and so that's, we separate them out. All right. And so we said there's two ways to control for what's called a confounder. It's mixing it up. You can't tell what's going on. There's just an association. You can't see what's driving this. Is it the shoe size or is it gender? So we said that two ways to investigate that is by, one way is by stratification, doing this, and another is by modeling, which means including the confounding variable, which would be gender, as a predictor variable in a regression model. And that's what we're going to look at right now. So that's what we're going to do right now. Okay, so here we are, and why don't we look at our real data and see if this is what we get. So this was data from what? Our spring survey one. Okay, so let's go and look at it, and we'll go to the document, to the PC here, And how do you get to this? So if you go back to our course webpage and you go to our data program, this is where you can find our data sets. And we're going to choose this data set. And I told you to look for what? Survey one. Whoa, where is it? Maybe I have to look at stat 100. Choose a data set. Survey one, spring 13 combined. All right. So you can see that 1,046 students responded. And here's the variables, and there's what's your shoe size, and how many pairs of shoes do you own. We're going to focus on that. So let's look at the scatter plot. And our x variable is the shoe size, and our predicting shoe, how many pairs of shoes. And there's that same exact scatter plot. And here is our regression line. And here is the regression equation, saying basically that the shoe number equals this intercept minus 2.154 times the shoe size. So that means that for each shoe size you go up, on the average, people buy 2.154 fewer pairs of shoes. And what's this intercept? That means if you have zero, it's sort of zero shoe size, then you would have, it doesn't really make sense. All right, because nobody has this, wears a size zero. So now, what do we want to do? We want to split into males and females. And so here you see that if you split, that goes, look, I'll show you again. You see how we have this negative correlation, but when we stratify and split, we get pretty much flat lines. Not completely flat. The slope didn't change to zero, but these slopes aren't significant. It's pretty flat. And then if you combine them again, you can see what's going on. So I coded the girls as purple and the boys as yellow. There's a lot more girls in Stat 100 than boys, at least, especially those who respond to the surveys. And you can see what's driving it. It's that if you look, just look at the girls, there's really two groups of people that we're combining here. And if we do a single show equal slopes, they're slightly different slopes. So there's a tiny, tiny effect, but it's not significant. And there's what it would look like if there's equal slopes. All right, so now you understand what's going on. Now I wanted to show you one. Now we want to work towards a multiple regression equation. All right, so we have this regression equation, and that is the variable shoe size, predicting shoe number. And we want to build a multiple regression model, so we want to add gender in. So here's what gender, just as a simple regression equation, even though gender is coded as zero for males and one for females. So here's what the equation for a regression would look like if you just have a binary predictor variable. And so why don't we look at what this means? And that's what we'll do on the next page. Okay, so let's see how to interpret this, because I don't think we've done this before. Most of you haven't done this before. So what does it mean to have a binary? How do you look at that? So we're on page 58 now. And all right, so what are we doing here? So we get this regression equation right here. Okay, and this is, and the way I coded it, this x, remember, we're predicting by gender, we're predicting the shoe number. And this x, the way I, okay, is 0. It's a 0, 1 variable. All binary variables are coded as 0, 1. And it's 0 for males. And x is equal to 1 for females. All right. So what is the regression? Let's make sense of this. This says, okay, so what does it give for males? it says that y is equal to 6.884 plus 12.86 times x. And when you're male, x is 0. So that crosses out, and that is the average. That point right there that it's giving you is the average for number of shoes for the thousand and some, for the however many men there were in that few hundred men. Okay? So this it says that our y value is just that. Y is equal to 6.884, or y is just the average for the males. Now let's see what it gives when you for females. So now we have 12.86, but now x is 1 for all females. So we add those together, and guess what we get? Yes, we get the average for females. All right, so that gives us, when you're a female, the best prediction we can give you is the average for all females. So that added together is 19.74, or then it predicts the average for females. Does that make sense? And what's this 12.86? This 12.86 is the difference. It's 19.74 minus 6.884, right? So basically, this equation, when it's for men, is saying, okay, I'm going to give you the male average plus the female average. Whoa, sorry, I wrote that bad. X bar for females. I'm going to give you the male average plus the female average minus the difference between the two of them times x. So when x is 1, this male average crosses out, you just get that. When x is 0, you get that. All right, so now what if we coded it? What if we coded it the reverse way? Well, then you're just going to switch the males and females here, right? If we coded it, what would it be? What would the regression equation be? Well, so if we coded female 0, so think, females are 0. So now y is going to be, you just take your female, is 19.74 plus something times x, right? And what do you think is going to go in there? Well, think about it. If I put the females here and the males here, I'm going to get 19.74 here. I'm going to get the same exact slope, but going down. So it's going to be negative 12.86. That's what it's going to look like. And you can think of it as when x is 0, you just have the average for the females, plus when x is 1, you're going to have the average for the males minus the average for the females. So that will cross out. So that's all we're doing. This is for females, and x equals 1 for males. All right? In other words, what are we doing here? We're saying 19.74 plus, inside here, we have 6.884 minus 19.74 times x. All right, so that's just the difference there. And so a binary variable is completely described by a 0, 1 variable. So if you have a binary variable, black, white, male, female, just you can just completely describe it by a 0, 1 variable. So just two categories. Pass, fail, live, die, whatever. Just two categories is fully described. Basically, success, failure is fully described by a 0, 1 variable, and it's arbitrary which one you assign to which one you assign to 0, which one you assign to 1. It will just switch your slope, the sign of your slope. Any questions on that? Yes. This one?
Yeah.
The logic behind this was, I was thinking, okay, my best prediction when they're female is what? Wouldn't it be the average of the females? If I want to predict how many shoes you have, you're a female, okay? And wouldn't I just do the average? So why, I mean, why am I even bothering with this? If I want to put it into a, but I want to create a variable that goes in a model. So I have to have a variable. I'm going to add this in our model. Whether somebody's male or female is going to be in our model, okay? So I want an equation of the form y is equal to an intercept plus something. And what I'm just based on your gender. So when this is 0, I'm just saying if you're 0, I want that to be the average, right? Now, if males are 1, so for a guy, I want 19 points this, and I want to end up with the guy's average. So I have to subtract off. I'm just looking at the difference between you. Take the female average, and what do I have to subtract off to get to 6.84, 19, you know? Because that's the intercept. That's in there. Does that make sense? Okay. Any other questions? All right. Now, what are we going to do? Now we have two simple regression equations. Now we have two simple regression equations, and one is for the shoe size, and one is gender, whether you're male or female, predicting how many shoes you have, and the other is how big your foot is. And the whole point is I want to like make a model instead of just splitting them apart. Another way that we can capture the effect of gender rather than just split it, because think about it, we're going to need, it's much more convenient to just put the variables in a model rather than splitting them all apart. We talked about this before. All right, so let's combine the both predictors. We're going to have a multiple regression with two slopes. This serves almost the same purpose as drawing two separate scatter plots for males and females, but it allows us to separate out the effects of each variable. So we're trying to do in a model what's beautifully done pictorially there. So what we're going to do? So we're going to say, okay, now we're predicting shoe size with two. This is x1 is what? Gender. So we have a slope for that. That's a 0, 1 variable. And x2 is the shoe size variable. And now, let's look at this. And now, it's harder to picture it because we're in three dimensions. But, I mean, we could picture it. But if we go, what we have to do now is we're going to, first of all, get the slopes. Here they are. And let me show you how to do it. Here, let me show you how to do this in our data program. So let's quickly go to the data program again, and here we go. So we're going to go home. Home here is where I want to go. No, data program. All right, so instead of clicking on scatter plots, that gives you this. I thought home right here is supposed to, yes. You click on home, and then you have a lot of options. A lot of options. There are 3D scatter plots. We could look at that later. We could do a 3D scatter plot of that. I could quickly show it to you if you want. So we choose our y variable. I have to choose our data set. We lost it. So we have to go back and choose our data set. Sorry to waste your time here. We have to go back and choose our data set. And so we're going to Stat 100, and we're choosing our data set, which is right here. And if we wanted to try the 3D plots, I forgot this, we just put this in here. We could. Let's see, look at that. So we would choose on our Y variable, we're trying to predict shoe number, right? And from gender, and shoe size. So basically, these are the females here, these are the males, and where's our regression plane? There is the equation for the regression plane, excuse me, that you see written. Well, we haven't written it down yet, but I'll show you how to get that equation. Sometimes it's hard to visualize this. I'm wondering if you can, Which axis is which? Can you see what we're doing? I know this has got to be the girls, because look at that. There's a lot more. So this is the gender axis here. This is the shoe number. See how the girls are going way up here? And our shoe size is this. So it's pretty flat here, pretty flat across here, because the shoe size doesn't have much effect. But this is the slope we're talking about. You see, there's a higher prediction. So it's basically when we have two variables, we're predicting a plane. So you can play around with this. I don't know, sometimes it's easier. People get a better feel for it. Whoa. It's kind of fun. But then you can also, let's go home here, and we are going to get the actual equation by looking at, look, when we add another slope, we're not going to be able to picture it. We'll be in four dimensions. So we are going to analyze it with an ANOVA table. So let's do that. So we get the, first of all, we're going to have to get our variables. So we have the Y variable is still shoe number, and we're predicting by gender and shoe size. Yeah. Okay. So here we have, now you can look at your F and T. You can look at the ANOVA table. You can get your, it's very significant, but look, the shoe size is not significant. The only slope that's significant is the gender. All right, and this right here, we can write as a regression equation, a multiple regression equation. So let's go over and do that. And let's go back to the document camera, and let's do that. All right, so here we go. First of all, I want you to notice that the shoe size is no longer significant. It's a tiny little slope. You saw it made no, hardly any difference. This is really small, and it's not significant. All right, now what do we have here? Let's look at this multiple regression equation. How did we get this? You get it from here. Zoom in a little bit. Okay, and what is that telling us? It's telling us that the number of shoes is equal to some intercept here, plus here's the slope for gender, 13.51, and here's that tiny slope for shoe size. This right here is very small. It's not quite zero, but it's not significant. All right? It's just, could easily just be due to the very chance error. So what does it simplify to for males? Let's look. So what does it simplify to for males? So for males, I coded this as x equals 0. So let's look at this. So we have the number of shoes, I'm just looking at this, equals our intercept 4.255 plus gender, but it's times 0, so that doesn't matter, plus 0.2472 times the shoe size. Compare it to for females. So females are x equals 1. Is that, sorry, that looks really, it's a little better. So this says the number of shoes, watch, equals 4.255 plus 13.51 times 1 plus 0.2472 times shoe size. So these two have the same slope. It forces them to have the same slope, which isn't too bad. Let me get wider a little bit. It isn't too bad because there's not much difference in slope. We'll go back and examine that picture, but you saw the slope for females is, I think, a little bigger, but not much different. So the same slope. So what is this saying? This is saying that the difference is, for males, we can add these together, and we get 17.765. So it's not exactly equal. There's a little shoe size effect, and it's forcing them to both be the same. So let's make sure that these are the same equations that we got when we split it on our data program. So let's just make sure. So let's keep looking at that and see if these are the, see if this is the equation for males and this is the equation for females. Let's just make sure. So we'll go back to our data program and we'll look at that, what we did before, the scatter plots here. And we said that, okay, we are predicting on the X, the we're predicting from shoe size, shoe number. And then we said, okay, we're going to split. And we didn't get those. Look, these are different. Then look at your paper. These are not, they don't have the same slope. This one's a little bigger, right? They don't have the same slope. When we combine them and force them, let's show equal slopes. These, when you force them to have, if you don't have show equal slopes, they're going to be slightly different. You see, oh, it's the males, this is, which one's slightly, the females, this one is slightly bigger slope right here, 0.3. It's still small, but it's slightly bigger. But now, multiple regression without an interaction term, which is our next chapter, the forces the same slope. We only have one slope term, so we force them to have the same slope. And these should be the exact equations that you have in your notebook. So what we're going to look at is, I mean, in this case, it's so close that it doesn't really matter. But what if there was quite a big difference? Then you'd want to include an interaction term. So that allows, in our multiple regression model, we have to include another term, gender times shoe size, that allows for different slopes for males and females. And that's what we're going to do in our next chapter. So let's go back to the document camera and see what else we need. Okay, so we finished this up, and so multiple regression makes predictions for y's based on more than one x variable. Right now we're looking at a quantitative and a binary variable. And if the different x's are correlated, the coefficients and the multiple are not the same. We saw that. They're far from the same. The coefficients were not the same. You know, look at this. What do I mean by that? We had a coefficient here of negative, a big effect for shoe size. But when we put it in the multiple regression, it disappeared to almost 0.2472. So they're not the same when you combine them. If the x variables are correlated, and of course they are correlated, I mean, how shoe size is correlated with gender. That's the whole reason why we're doing this. We thought they were confounded. So under some circumstances, multiple regression can be used to separate the causal effect of X on Y from the confounding due to other X's. So that's what we're trying to do here. And it forces the same slope for all levels of each variable. And a binary variable is typically expressed as a 0-1 variable. Now, what we're going to do is, how do we fit a model with, if we want different slopes? And that's the next thing we're going to do with interactions. So I think that's it. And have a great weekend. And you've got a lot of homework. So come for help today. You can look over your homework if you need it. Or tomorrow, 3 to 5 would be a good time to come for help. Before, you know, you probably are exhausted now. But from 3 to 5 tomorrow is a good time. Now we've got to